Happy Sabbath, everyone. It warms my heart to see all my brothers and sisters in Christ here. Praise the Lord. Well, I am one of the team leaders for the fellowship lunch that happened with this church, with our home here. And I'm in charge of the third Sabbath of the month. And we have other fellowship teams for other Sabbaths, but this is the one that I'm sharing about. And I was impressed to share some ingredients for a good fellowship lunch through the Word of God. And I'll start off with a welcome on 2 Corinthians 13:14. May the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Now, when we have fellowship lunch, the desire from heaven is that we are having fellowship through the Holy Spirit. And through that, we grow closer together, not further apart. Also in Acts 2, I would share, those who accepted this message were baptized and 3,000 were added to the number that day. This was a time when everyone was together and the Holy Spirit was upon the apostles. And they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to fellowship, to the breaking of bread and prayer. Everyone was filled with awe at all the many wonders and signs performed by the apostles. When it comes to fellowship lunch, it's a time for us to share with one another as we partake with the food at the table. And when we share, I get to find out the journey you've been through, and you get to find out the journey I've been through, and trust me, we will be at awe at what God has done in our individual lives. That's why I believe when it says the breaking of bread and to prayer, is that whatever is at the fellowship lunch table, God's will is for us to eat heavenly food by sharing with each other the goodness of God. In 1 Corinthians 1:8 to 10, I share, he says, he will also keep you firm to the end, and so that you will be blameless on the day of the Lord Jesus Christ. I pause there. Firm, this is a hard place to be growing up in. This whole entire world is kind of turned upside down, and the pressures can be unbearable. And also, I feel for the people that work like 80-hour weeks, 70-hour weeks, because I used to work tremendous hours. And, you know, one day would be January 1st, and I wake up, and the next day it's March 30th. Like, what happened? And sometimes we're so overwhelmed with work that life is actually literally passing us by. If we have our faith in Christ and trust that he will keep us firm the way I just read to the end, we don't have to rely on ourselves so much. We don't have to rely on our jobs and the employers, you know, the income itself. God will keep us firm. We could trust in him. And I continue on verse 9. God is faithful, who has called you. Who? He's called you. He's called you. He's called you. He's called you. He's called me. He's called our visitors today. He's called our members today. He's called our extended family and friends and the ones watching on video. He's called us into fellowship with his son. The most important fellowship that we can have is with his son. Jesus Christ, our Lord, I appeal to you, brothers and sisters, in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, that all of you agree with one another in what you say, and in that there is no divisions among you, but that you be perfectly united in mind and thought. Now, when I read that, how pleasing that is to the ears. But in reality, if we don't get to know one another, if we're not sharing, studying the Word of God, fellowshipping with one another, how are we going to get to that point that we're all united? There is one truth, but I think if we get together, we might come across a few interpretations. But together, as we fellowship, we will get closer to each other because the Word is telling us. through Jesus Christ, we are brothers and sisters. The person on your right, the person on your left is your brother and sister in Christ. The person sitting in front of you, behind you, is your brother or sister in Christ. This is the word, this is what the word of the Lord says. So let's get to know one another, and I suggest through fellowship lunch. Can be one avenue. Also, where is fellowship lunch? Well, in the rotunda today is fellowship lunch. But fellowship lunch next weekend can be at your home. You can invite someone that you don't know very well in your church and get to know them better. So fellowship lunch is not limited, of course, to the rotunda outside. It could be your home. And I will gladly have you over, and I'll gladly come over if you have me. In John 6 was when there was a multitude of people listening to Jesus. And you could relate this to the church. There was a multitude, just like there's a multitude here on the mountain. There was a multitude of people listening to Jesus, the word, read the word of God. Jesus said, and then he said, have the people sit down. There's plenty of grass and a place for them to sit down. And there's about 5,000 of them. And the apostles were telling them, hey, send them home. You know, they're going to get a little antsy. You know, they haven't eaten. Their stomachs are going to make that sound. They're going to get edgy. Jesus said, no, no, no. Have them sit down. Jesus then took the loaves and gave thanks and contributed those who were seated as much as they wanted. As some of you might recall through the word of God, this little boy had this awesome mom that made him lunch on the way to church. And the disciples said to Jesus, this is the only one that brought food. And Jesus saw that to be more than enough. So today there's fellowship lunch. And many of my team members that help contribute are not here this weekend because of graduation dedications in different churches are praying for their graduates, depending what church they went to. So the whole team is not here. So the lunch is there. And usually there's even more than there is now. But I believe, I have faith, just like Jesus took this little boy's lunch and it was sufficient for all, that our lunch this afternoon is sufficient for whoever wants to come. Visitors are welcome, members, everyone is welcome. Then Jesus declared in verse 35, I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never go hungry. Whoever believes in me will never be thirsty. So that teaches me I can't have the excuse that, well, I didn't bring lunch. I'm too embarrassed to go eat somebody else's lunch. Let me go to the store and buy lunch. But that's not what this is saying. This is saying that Jesus is the bread of life. And what he supplies is always going to be sufficient. You will not go away hungry. In 36 says, but as I told you, you have seen me and still you do not believe me. All those the Father gives me will come to me, and whosoever comes to me, I will never drive away. For I have come down from heaven not to do my will, but to do the will of him who sent me. And this is the will of him who sent me, that I shall lose none of these that have given me, but raise them up in the last day. So what he's sharing here, as plain English as he's describing to all of us, is that God has purposed all of us to be united in him. God has purposed every one of you through the Holy Spirit impressed you to come here to, in as united as we are now, to grow through the message that was prepared for us today, which is the manna from heaven that God has sent, and also to partake together and to edify each other by lifting up Jesus Christ. Verse 40 says, for my Father's will is that everyone who looks to the Son and believes in him shall have everlasting life, and I will raise them up that last day. God's desire is for us to have everlasting life together. And his will is that we all know that we're brothers and sisters and that we grow closer together. So I invite you through today or any other fellowship lunch. And where is fellowship lunch? I believe it starts in the heart. The heart that God has turned from stone into his heart. Because when Jesus died for us, he died for us all. So let's praise the Lord continuously of his goodness. Thank you.
Thank you. It's good to see all your smiling faces here today. Before I want to welcome everybody, I have just a couple items. One of them is some church business. Another one is an announcement. The first is two nominees that we have. They are listed in your bulletin. These are second readings for positions to be filled. Number one is Deacon Miguel Santiago and Women's Ministries Assistant Evelini Bush. So these are the nominees I bring before you. Do we have a motion to accept those to serve in those capacities? Do we have a second? All in favor, show of hands. Thank you. Any opposed? I didn't think so. So thank you, Miguel and Evelini Bush, to the ministries that they are willingly and happily serving in. The second one is an announcement. I'm just going to turn it over to our projectionist to share this announcement from Elder Ed Keyes, who's our conference president here in Arizona.
Hi, everyone. I'm Ed Keyes, the president of the Arizona Conference, and I want to invite you to a very special camp meeting this year. While camp meeting is not the full 9 days as it will be next year, we do have a special 5 days of camp meeting. I'd like to invite you to all the programs. It will be live streamed on Good News TV. However, if you're there in person, you're going to receive a special blessing. We have guest speakers Lee Vendon and Gary Vendon, who will be doing a special program in the morning and in the evening. Paul Blake, one of our pastors, will be doing the morning devotionals and has a wonderful program lined up for you. Dr. Yugata Woods will be doing our medical talks, our health talks, and we're so thankful for her. And Alan Reinick will be giving us a unique insight into religious liberty items that are facing the country these days. And I also want to invite you to be a part of our guest musicians who will be there as well. Marilyn Vendon will be singing, and Tim Parton from 3ABN will be one of our featured musicians. We'll have a social program Tuesday night and Thursday night. And of course, the ABC will be open. Sandy will be there with all the goodies that you need, all the supplies you need to keep your home happy and your churches happy as well. Children and youth programs will be there every day as well. So don't miss this opportunity, June 14 to 18, to be a part of a very special camp meeting. We still have plenty of cabin space available. Our RV space is pretty well full, but we want you to be a part of this program. Sign up, give the Arizona Conference a call, and be a part of a wonderful experience, a mountaintop experience at Camp Yavapai Pines in Prescott this year.
Big thank you to Ed and those that have been planning this special event that we call camp meeting from summer to summer. We haven't had a big camp meeting in a long time, right? Anybody like camp meeting out there? Do we have any camp meeting likers, lovers? Okay, yeah, quite a few. Well, I hope to see you there, and if you can't come up for the whole time, certainly for that Sabbath, we will have things going on here as well, but we will live stream the message from camp meeting here that Sabbath, the same Sabbath as camp meeting. So I look forward to that. I want to extend a welcome to each and every one of you who have decided to worship here this morning at the Camelback Seventh-day Adventist Church. We're glad that you are here. We're a little less in number today because I know we're competing with graduation weekend at Thunderbird Adventist Academy. So I know many of our members are there supporting our graduates, and so that's a good thing. But we're glad that you are here today because we have a special service planned for you, lots of good things that we want to bring before you, but most importantly, we want to worship Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen. Do we have any guests, first-time guests? Okay, welcome. Thank you for being here. Welcome. Wonderful. We're glad that you have chosen to worship with us today. There is a fellowship luncheon. I know that Belinda, thank you so much, Belinda, for your, there you are, for your feature, your ministry feature there. Belinda and Hugh Miller also are key parts of our fellowship lunch. There is a fellowship lunch today, as she announced, so if you don't have a plan, come by and enjoy a haystack with us. If you don't know what a haystack is, come check it out. All right, I'm going to read from Ezekiel chapter 36, beginning with verse 24. For I will take you from among the nations, gather you out of all countries, and bring you into your own land. Then I will sprinkle clean water on you, and you shall be clean. I will cleanse you from all your filthiness and you from all your idols. I will give you a new heart and put a new spirit within you. I will take the heart of stone out of your flesh and give you a heart of flesh. I will put my spirit within you and cause you to walk in my statutes, and you will keep my judgments and do them. Then you shall dwell in the land that I gave to your fathers. You shall be my people, and I will be your God. Isn't that a beautiful promise? Father in heaven, we pray for the outpouring of your spirit upon your people gathered here today. Lord, touch our hearts and come into our lives in ways we have not experienced before, because we know that you are the great God who is capable of changing that heart of stone into a heart of flesh. Spend this time with us, and may our worship of you be full of praise and gratitude for all that you have done. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Good morning, church family. Let's rise together and step into the presence of the Lord and sing Sweet, Sweet Spirit. Let's release the tensions of the week and come into the presence of the Lord and sing together.
There's a sweet, sweet spirit in this place, and I know that it's the Spirit of the Lord. There are sweet expressions on each face, and I know they feel the presence of the
much. And in case you haven't seen it in your hymnal or your bulletin already, please be seated. In case you haven't seen it in your bulletin already, it's Hymn Sing Sabbath. Please, let's grab those hymnals and let's take some selections that you, some favorite, beloved, touching hymns that you'd like us to sing together. We're a smaller group today, and so we're gonna sing like a small town church family. So do you have those hymnals in front of you, and have you picked out a song that is your favorite? Let's hear it. 2, 4, 5. Okay. Yell it out. 327? Okay. 327. A few more. I'm sorry, 251? Okay. One. All right. 528. 528. Let's have a couple more. 44. Did I hear one back here? No, no, no. Ah, you, sir. 487. Okay, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. This should be plenty. We will go select a couple of verses from each and be back in a few minutes to sing. Thank you.
Good morning. I get to talk about Thunderbird Christian Elementary. I know they're having graduation right now at TAA, but TCE just finished our school year, and we are so excited to share with you some of the things that have been happening. Our motto at our school is Training for Eternity. And one of the things that we do every day is we talk about our aim and motto. So our first part is to train our minds to always do our best. And yes, our students have the motions to go with. So you see that we are doing our best to make sure that our students have the best academic experience at TCE. We're also training our bodies to be His temple. So we have plenty of recess and time to get outside, but we also have our students outside growing things. I got to taste some of the beans and the peas. Oh, they were fabulous. But they have a nice garden out there for grades K through 3. They've been growing, and those plants are just huge. They're doing such a great job. And then we're training our hearts to be like God. And so that is what makes TCE something better. Now, any school provides a good quality education. Any school provides exercise and strengthening of the body. But only our Adventist schools can provide your child with a strong Christian outlook on everything that they do. Because we don't just teach Bible, we teach God in every subject, in every way. So it is something better than just any other school. We've had a music program this year. We didn't have an official music teacher. We did have some volunteers that came in. We borrow the music teacher from the high school that does our 5 through 8 band. And then we have a volunteer. You can see Miss Carla in the middle there. And she was there almost every day for the last 3 weeks, helping us create a program where we celebrated cultures from around the world and sang songs in several different languages and had a wonderful time. And then we also had one of our teachers teach recorders. So we're doing what we can. Next year, we're hoping to have a teacher on staff to do our music for us. So we're really excited about that. With our academics, I just wanted to show you how we've done. This is actually our mid-year scores instead of our end of the year, because we haven't gotten finished with those end of the year scores and getting them ready. But this, our MAP testing, our measure of academic progress, can be compared to the state and to national norms. So you see our national norm score that our average students in K through 8 would have is 192.41. The Pacific Union Conference, which is the middle score, is 191.6, very close. But I want you to notice TCE's scores. Our score was 194.2. So we outperformed not only the Pacific Union, but also the national norms. So we are pretty proud. And this is just our mid-year scores. Our end-of-the-year scores were even better. So we are really excited about how our students are doing. We just finished graduation. We graduated 14 eighth graders and 4 kindergartners. So we had such a wonderful time with that. And they got to show off some of the things they've done. And just, it was a beautiful ceremony. And if you ever get a chance, please attend one of them. They're just fantastic. So what are our dreams for the future? Well, first of all, it is registration time. So if you know any students that go to school in grades kinder through eighth grade, or even preschool, transitional kindergarten, we are enrolling right now, and our goal is to have 100 students this year, and we are hoping God sends every one of them. Now, this current year, we started out our year with only about 70 kids, and we ended up with almost 90. So God really blessed this year, and we want growth again next year. So if you know anyone that would like to enroll, please send them our way. But some of our other dreams are to have one-to-one devices for each of our students so that every student has the opportunity to have a computer to use, a Chromebook to use throughout the day. And we don't have to shift them from one room to the next. Our next dream is to have a fully stocked and integrated STEM lab. I've been telling you a little bit about it. One of the things that our students got to do, in fact, I see Aaliyah here, she got to learn to draw blood. And so we're going to be stocking our lab this summer, but we would love to have it completely filled with career-based STEM modules. And then we will become the training lab for all of our other Adventist schools in the state of Arizona. And then next summer, when we have our National Teachers Convention here for the NAD, we will then be a training center there. So that is our dream that we're looking forward to and planning. And then our other dream is to have our art, PE, and music programs fully in place for our, so our teachers will have that assistance and that help, and they won't have to teach all of those things. They will actually have a little break to do some extra planning to make our instruction even better. So I just wanted to let you know. And what can we do? What can you do to help? Well, first of all, you can pray. Prayers make amazing differences. So please pray for our students, our school, and our programming. And we would also love for you to volunteer. If you would like to volunteer, please call our office anytime this summer and we will get you lined up. If you have a talent, or even if you feel like you don't have a talent, we can always use your help. If all you think you can do is just clean, we'd love to have somebody help clean and organize this summer as we get everything prepared for the next year. If you can cut, glue, put things together in packages, we can use your help too. So even if you don't feel like you are qualified to read with students, come on over and you can help anyway. And then we also would appreciate your support financially. So anything that you would like to do to help us out, we would love to have you. So thank you so much for supporting TCE.
Good morning. It is time for children's story. So would all the children like to come up and sit and listen to my story? Come on up. Looks like we'll have some help. Come on, Avery. You can come on up too. You want to come all down here, guys? Come on down here closer to me. I have a story about some animals. How many of you know what a sea otter is? Have you ever seen a sea otter? They kind of look like this. They like to be on the ocean, and they like to swim on their backs. They have a very, very important role. Did you know that? Sea otters have an important role? Well, sea otters, as cute as they can be, with their funny whiskers and their bright eyes, they like to float on their back on the ocean, and they like to swim around, and they like to play tag with other sea otters and flip around in the water. They really know how to play. They know all the different kinds of swimming games and sliding games and chasing games. If you were going to be another something else, I think a sea otter would be fun. Now, sea otters are more than just fun and games, though. They are important to our environment. Did you know that sea otters like to eat urchins? Urchins live on the bottom of the sea, and they like to eat kelp. Kelp is that long, skinny seaweed that goes from the bottom. But you know what? Kelp help other animals survive. And sea urchins, if they could, they would eat that kelp all day long, and pretty soon there'd be no more kelp. And that would be very dangerous for the animals who like to live in the kelp and hide in the kelp. Now, guess who comes to the rescue? The sea otters. The sea otters dive down and they grab the sea urchins and then they bring them up to the surface and then they flip over on their backs and they put the sea urchin on their tummy, and guess what? They have a lovely snack of sea urchin. Now, by eating the sea urchin, the sea otters help preserve the kelp forests. And you know what the sea otters didn't know? They didn't know that they were helping the environment. They just do it because they like eating sea urchins. It's a natural thing for them to do. But being helpful is not really a natural thing for humans to do. Sometimes it's hard to help others. The Bible text from Galatians 5:13 says, serve each other with love. Okay? It tells us that we should serve everybody, but serving others doesn't come naturally for people. But you know what? Fortunately, it's Jesus' nature. Jesus is good and kind and loving and helpful. And you know what? Jesus will share this nature with you. With his help, it can be natural for us to serve others. All right, so it can be as joyful as maybe playing with a little brother and sister. That would be serving others. It could be as natural as picking up your things at home, helping to clean, helping your mom, helping your dad. Maybe just keeping a little brother or sister entertained while mom and dad are busy. Those are other ways that you can serve others. But you know what? My challenge today is for you, no matter how big or how small you are, is find some way that you can serve others. Okay? All right, let's say a real quick little prayer. Dear Jesus, help us to be happy servants for all. We can do that by listening to you and talking to you and helping and listening to the way that you guide us. Help us to have a great day for the rest of our Sabbath. In your name we pray, amen. All right, you can go back to your places now. Now,
thank you so much, Gloria. Gloria is our kindergarten teacher at Thunderbrook Christian Elementary. And so wonderful to have Thunderbird here representing today. They've already graduated their eighth grade class, yet they're involved in the church stuff. Isn't that great, Camelback? Amen. Thank you so much, Chandra and Gloria, for being here with us to tell us what wonderful things are happening at TCE. You know, it is one of the most amazing things for a pastor to baptize his own children. And we have that story today. Pastor Bernd Jutt started his ministry in Central States Conference in the Mid-American Union in 2000 after graduating from Union College with a degree in theology. Pastor Jutt served as a pastor of the South Sudanese SDA Church in Omaha, Nebraska, which he helped to start and to organize. He also became a missionary to Cyprus and Lebanon, where he served as director of evangelism for the Middle East Union Mission. The Union headquarters later moved to Beirut, Lebanon, where he also spent 5 years of his missionary service. So he is a well-traveled pastor and missionary. Pastor Yut also attended Grace University and Bernalillo University, where he earned a master's and PhD. He has since returned to South Sudan, where he was born and currently serves the church as a local pastor, also spending time here in Nebraska as well. Pastor Yut has traveled back here specifically for this wonderful, beautiful occasion to be able to baptize his two daughters. Dewine and Warragak are both coming in as members here at the Seventh-day Adventist Church. You're going to want to get to know them. Not long ago, they said that they had moved fairly local to this area, so we're going to embrace them today with open arms. And I'm so excited, not only for them, but Pastor Byrne, for you in baptizing your daughters. God bless you.
Good morning, church. Today is a happy day for me and my family. These two young ladies have started a school in a church in Lebanon when we were missionaries. Today they have committed their life to Jesus Christ, so I'm so happy to be able to baptize them. Thank you for your support, and I hope that you will help them to grow in the church when they become full members of your church. Thank you. Dwayne Burnput, because you've accepted the Lord to be your Lord and Savior, today I baptize you in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. Warragak Burnput, because of your commitment to follow the Lord as your Savior, today I baptize you in the name of Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
I'd also like to recognize not only their father, who was the pastor baptizing them, but they also have family here. Could you stand, please, the rest of the family who are here to support and yes, amen. Thank you so much for being here. God bless you. God bless you. We look forward to getting to know you a little better. I know you're fairly close by. So we'll look forward to getting to know not only you, but your daughters as well. God bless.
And let's sing together, the family of God. Let's pick up our hymnals and turn to hymn number 44, Morning Has Broken, hymn number 44. We're going to sing verses 1 and 3. Praise for the morning,
fresh from the Word. Mine is the sunlight, mine is the morning, born of the one light Eden saw play. Praise with elation, praise every morning, God's recreation of the new day.
That's warmed us up a little bit. Let's turn forward now to hymn number 251. 251. He lives. Hymn number 251. We're also going to sing verses 1 and 3. Sing out.
I serve the risen Savior. He's in the world today. I know that he is living, whatever men may say. I see his hand of mercy. I hear his voice of cheer. And just the time I need him, he's always near. He lives, he lives. Christ Jesus lives today. He walks with me and talks with me along life's narrow way. He lives, he lives. Salvation to impart. You ask me how I know he lives. He lives within my heart. Rejoice, rejoice, O Christian. Lift up your voice and sing. Eternal hallelujahs to Jesus Christ the King, the hope of all who seek him, the help of all who find. None other is so loving, so good and kind. He lives, Christ Jesus lives today. He walks with me and talks with me along life's narrow way.
I can hear you. I can hear you singing. It sounds so good. Turn forward to, back one, I'm sorry, to 245. 245, more about Jesus. Forward to 487, 487 in the garden. I can hear you singing. You sound so beautiful. Remember to keep singing out with confidence. 487.
Discloses, and with me and he talks with me and he tells me I am his own. And the joy we share as we tarry there, none other has ever known. I'd stay in the garden with him, though the night around me be falling, but he bids me go through the voice I know. His voice to me is calling, and he walks with me and he talks with me and he tells me I am his own. And the joy we share as we tarry there, none other has ever known.
You sound so beautiful, and I appreciate you helping me sing, especially as I'm kind of faking it in my upper range with allergies. Turn forward to 528, hymn number 528. I think we've gotten them all. I'm sorry, what? Which one did I miss? I'd rather have Jesus, 327. Yep, I'm sorry. Let's go back to 327. I'd rather have Jesus. We cannot let one of these fall off the table. 327. One and three.
Untold. I'd rather have Jesus than houses or lands. I'd rather be led by his nail-pierced hand. And to be the king of a vast domain, or be held in sin's dread sway. I'd rather have Jesus than anything this world affords today. He's fairer than lilies of rarest bloom. He's sweeter than honey from out the comb. He's all that my hungering spirit needs. I'd rather have Jesus and let him lead. And to be the king of a vast domain, or be held in sin's dread sway. I'd rather have Jesus than anything this world affords today.
And now forward to hymn number 528. 528. A shelter in a time of storm.
A shelter in the time of storm, secure whatever may betide. A shelter in the time of storm. Mighty rock in a weary land, cooling shade on the burning sand. Faithful guide for the pilgrim band. A shelter in the time of storm. shelter in the time of storm. Be thou our helper ever near, a shelter in the time of storm. Mighty rock in a weary land, cooling shade on the burning sand, faithful God for the pilgrim band, a shelter in the time of storm.
Amen. You sounded so beautiful. Thank you for another Hymn Sing Sabbath.
Good morning, church family. What a wonderful beginning to the Sabbath. Two just most special baptisms, and I just wish each and every one of you could be up here to hear how wonderful everyone sounds. Today's offering is for our Camelback Church Ministries, and this is such an important ministries across the board. But what I wanted to share with you this morning is one we recently highlighted at our church, and that deals with evangelism. For the past two weekends, on Thursday, Friday, and Saturday evenings, and then on the second weekend on Saturday Sabbath, Pastor John led out and presented with us a prophetic signs seminar right here at Camelback. We also had it live streamed with Good News TV. Our number one and our focus here at church is to know Jesus Christ, to grow in God's grace, and to share his love. Evangelism is a key that helps us as a church lead people to Jesus. Sharing our good news message with our community was a key focus during this special series. Whether people came as new, curious about who God was, or is, so many others simply have slipped away, and they wanted to reconnect with Jesus, and their lives get so busy. Anyway, whoever the seekers might be, we at Camelback wanted to provide an opportunity to learn about Jesus, perhaps connect for the first time, or simply reconnect with him again in a special relationship. Hundreds of people signed up for this. Praise God. Our attendance at church was probably each evening 40 to 50 people. Bible truths were brought to light. Also, religious misconceptions were also revealed and addressed. So many people today are living without the light of God. And this was no small undertaking. Timing, planning, execution of this series was multifaceted and crucial. First of all, we need to give glory to God for allowing us as a team and everyone to put this together. Pastor John, he moved on me. Anyway, Pastor, thank you so much for your time leading through this and having God inspire you to share this series with us. Thank you so much. So many wonderful seeds of truth were planted, not only here at Camelback, but today's technologies and live streaming capabilities, who knows how many hearts were touched. Thank you, Pastor, for allowing God to lead you and give you strength and guidance through this series. Just so everyone knows, this is a team event. Thousands of promotional flyers were targeted and hand-delivered to the neighborhoods around Camelback. Thank you, Souls West, for help and assistance with this huge task. With today's technologies, we are able to utilize Facebook to help advertise to get the word out as well. To see our church family members coming each evening in person and bringing a guest with them to share Jesus was so special to see. Thank you all so much for participating in this series. Thank you all also that joined us online. There's a huge audience here, And we know God's love will come right to your heart as well. So many seeds of Bible truth were planted. One day we will see how many lives were touched by everyone's collective efforts. Thank you so much. Good News TV, thank you. People involved in tracking the online, people inquiring here, thank you so much. So many behind the scenes areas that I just wanted to share. Our church members came here to personally greet, welcome, and have them feel comfortable with our church. For our Camelback's children's ministries, to help them learn more about Jesus at a young age. And lastly, we all know how music is so very important to bring God into our lives. Rochelle, and Natalia and Velody Nesterik, as well as Jesus Music Ministry. I cannot say how special all their efforts were with music through this entire series. Here's my point. There's a huge financial obligation to have an outreach series like this. Thank you all, Camelback Church. Thank you very much. Thank you all that are viewing at home. Thank you for your financial contributions to make this series even possible. It's because of your support that we're able to help draw others just a little bit closer to God in these critical days we're now living in. Ellen White writes in the Testimonies of the Church, "Let the workers watch for their chance for presenting the message for this time. Let them be quick to seize opportunities to speak to the people, accompanied by the power of the Holy Spirit. The Word of God is to be presented with clearness and power, that those who have ears to hear may hear the truth." Let us pray. Father in heaven, thank you, Lord, for your never-ending love for us. Thank you for touching the hearts of so many that they desire to either financially or personally help spread your wonderful good news in your soon return. Help us all each day, Lord, listen to your voice and follow the path you have chosen for our lives, and draw us closer to you. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
Happy Sabbath, everyone. And I would like to invite everyone online as well as here who is able to, if you want, kneel down as we talk to our Father. Dear Heavenly and Gracious Father, we thank you, Lord, for inviting us here to gather and fellowship, but more to come and speak to you with our petitions. We come before your throne, Lord, thanking you and praising you for waking us up this morning and giving us another day of life. Lord, as we see the world and we know things are changing and we see the many changes, we can count on one thing for sure, and that's that you do not change. You are the same always, and we can depend on you for everything. We thank you, Lord, because we don't need to look for you, because you look for us before we even come to you. Your Holy Spirit wakes us up. It tells us what words to pray. It tells us to be joyful and thankful. It gives us hope in you, knowing that you came and the enemy is already defeated. We can hold on to the hope that your soon coming is near. The signs show it all. And we have nothing to fear, for you say it yourself, "Fear not, I am with you. In everything, I will never leave you nor forsake you." And we can hold on to that promise. Lord, I pray for the graduation of the youth that's going to take tonight and tomorrow. Be with our youth, Lord. They are the future of your church, our church. I pray that your Holy Spirit will continue to guide them into the path that you have already prepared for them, and that they may choose wisely, because that's the one thing you do give us, Lord, and that's the freedom to choose. Let us choose your path. Lord, I pray for the speaker today that you be with him, that your words will speak through him and in him, and that it will touch every single heart here and online. I thank you, Lord, for showing how you pray and watch for us to choose you and get baptized. Lord, what a blessing for this father to see his daughters choose you and to be able to baptize them in your name. What a blessing, Lord. That's what you said with Adam and Eve when you told them to be fruitful and multiply, was to multiply your character, who you are. And I pray that we continue this, each and every father, online mother who's praying for their children. I pray for them as well, Lord, that you continue guiding them and bringing them for those who have left. We pray that they may come back. For those who are walking and learning, that they may continue to grow in you. We thank you, Lord, for the blessings you bestowed on each and every person here throughout the week. You got us here safely. We are here now to commune with you. Thank you for opening your door and for allowing us to open our hearts to you. We thank you and praise you. We ask if there's any prayer that is silent, Lord, that you may hear it and answer it according to your will. I thank you and praise you in the wonderful and blessed name of your Son, Jesus. Amen.
Today's scripture reading will be found in Acts 1, 4 through 11. And being assembled together with them, he commanded them not to depart from Jerusalem, but to wait for the promise of the Father, which he said, "You have heard from me. For John truly baptized with water, but you shall be baptized with the Holy Spirit not many days from now." Therefore, when they had come together, they asked him, saying, "Lord, will you at this time restore the kingdom to Israel?" And he said to them, "It is not for you to know the times or the seasons which the Father has put in his own authority. But you shall receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you shall be witnesses to me in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the end of the earth." Now when he had spoken these things, while they watched, he was taken up, and a cloud received him out of their sight. And while they looked steadfastly toward heaven, as he went up, behold, two men stood by them in white apparel, who also said, "Men of Galilee, why do you stand gazing up into heaven? This same Jesus who was taken up from you into heaven will so come in like manner as you saw him go into heaven."
Well done. Lillian just finished second grade. On her way to third. They all grow up too fast. Oh, she just finished third. Oh, I stand corrected. Yes, going into fourth grade. My wife Rochelle teaches fourth grade, so she sees ones about her age just about every day. So would you bow your heads as we seek the Lord's blessing before I begin? Father in heaven, we just pray for your spirit to fill this place, to fill my mind, to speak to me and through me to the minds of your people. We need to hear from you today. In Jesus' name, amen. Have you ever reached the end of a movie and immediately thought, then what? Well, all these characters I've invested about an hour and a half in, then what? What's going on from here? I know Rochelle and I have done that many times. Boy, these old movies end very abruptly sometimes. You're wondering, well, what's next? Then what? You know, we can think sometimes the same thought about someone who has given themselves to Jesus Christ. We think immediately, well, happily ever after. It's theirs. The end has occurred. It's all good. But the reality is that each of us have a then what to live. You see, Jesus is the beginning of the journey. Amen? Not the end of the journey. He's the beginning. You and I, we are living with him in the then what. The disciples were familiar with this as well. As Bella just read us in the passage for this morning, that the disciples, as they looked up toward heaven, as Jesus was ascending out of their sight, behold, two men of them stood by them in white apparel, and it says that they said to the disciples, "Men of Galilee, why do you stand gazing up into heaven? This same Jesus who was taken up from you into heaven will so come in like manner as you saw him go into heaven." You see, they had spent all this time with Jesus. They invested every bit of energy. They were ready to die with Jesus. And now the end seemed to have come. Then what? They faced the then what. And it's interesting, in the very next text it says, then. Then they returned to Jerusalem from the mount called Olivet, which is near Jerusalem, a Sabbath day's journey. And when they had entered, they went up into the upper room where they were staying. They continued with one accord in prayer and supplication with the women and Mary, the mother of Jesus, and with his brothers. Then what? Then they got together and they stayed together. One of the most important things we can do as a church family is to stay together. It's to pray together. It's to do life together. And in prayer, because it says they were praying and they were asking the Lord for his blessing. As they prayed, they didn't just pray individually, they prayed together. It's something that we've been trying to instill here at Camelback a culture of praying together. Not just once a week when we come for church and we worship, but every week, chances and opportunities for us to pray together. Tuesday nights, Wednesday morning, the prayer collective. Wednesday nights, we get together for our Bible study and prayer time. If you've missed out on that, you're missing out on one of the most important things we can do. Pray together. Corporate prayer is indispensable if the church wants to receive power to do the work that God has given us to do. Can you see it? You see, they could have just gone out immediately and said, oh, Jesus is gone, let's just start preaching. But they didn't. They said, remember what he told us, we need to wait. Let's get together and let's pray. And let's set aside differences. And let's encourage one another as we wait for the promised blessing. I was doing some studying for the message here this Sabbath, and I came across an interesting story. Do you know what the third largest city in California is? The third largest. What would you think is the first two? L.A., San Francisco, right? Okay. What would be the third largest? So I heard San Diego. Any others? Sacramento, okay. The third largest city in California is not Los Angeles, San Francisco, San Diego, Sacramento. By land area, it's California City. And this is what California City looks like. In the late 1950s, a master plan was developed to make it larger than Los Angeles. This is right on the heels of the war. Families were growing. They wanted to find a new place where they could create a city that people could build and afford housing and grow their families. Lots sold like crazy. Homes were built. But today, only 14,000 people live there. And much of it looks like a ghost town. Lofty plan, huh? But it didn't work. God has a master plan for his church. Hear me out. God has a master plan for his church. The church is here for a reason. Not just to save you and to save me, but to save everyone he possibly can through our testimony. And I've said this many times. What if the disciples never shared the gospel? What if they just went back to the work that they did? Where would the church be today? Instead of a ghost town by man's doing, God wants to make his church a Holy Ghost town, filled with the Holy Spirit, with members that are thriving, engaged in the work of sharing the gospel, in whatever sphere of influence God has put you in. We all have different work and places we socialize and all the stuff we do. That's your sphere of influence. Well, God has a plan to use you in that sphere. And he wants to put his Spirit in you to do it. This is what Jesus told them to pray for. Pray for the Holy Spirit. He says in Acts 1, verse 4, and being assembled together with them, he commanded them not to depart from Jerusalem, but to do what? Wait for what? Wait. Come on. Wait for the promise of the Father, which he said, you have heard from me. For John truly baptized with water, but you shall be baptized with the Holy Spirit not many days from now. Wait until I baptize you. But wait, I've already been baptized in the water. Not wait. Because the baptism that's coming from the Father at the request of Jesus is the Holy Spirit in your heart and in your mind. It doesn't, well, Jesus, let's talk about this. What if the Spirit hadn't come? Could they have done things? Could they have preached a message? Sure. The question isn't, could they have done things? Did they have work to do or not? The question is, who's empowering the work? Who's the one that's helping them accomplish the mission that Christ had given them? Go, therefore, and do what? Baptize and preach and teach, and I will be with you wherever you go. The Great Commission. You see, God asked them to do what was humanly impossible. And I'll tell you what, we're looking at around at a world with 7 billion people today. That is the definition of impossible. In preaching this series here over the last couple weekends, I stand up here from night to night, and the thought comes through my head. I can't reach 7 people, let alone, you know, 4.5 million people, let alone 7 billion, right? God has to take control of the work. It's not my work, it's His work. It's not my gospel, it's His gospel. Here's a tougher one. It's not my life, it's His life through me. And that's often the toughest part. Well, then it happened. In Acts 2, it says that the day of Pentecost had fully come, and they were all with one accord in one place, and suddenly there came a sound from heaven as of a rushing mighty wind, and it filled the whole house where they were sitting. Then there appeared to them divided tongues as of fire, and one sat upon each of them. And they were all filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. Now, it doesn't say that they were praying at that moment. In fact, it says that they were sitting down. They were sitting there. I don't know if they were having a conversation. Maybe some of them were praying. But this is 10 days spent in the upper room, and this is the result. What we learn from the story is that their hearts were together. They were not separate. They were together. And not just together in heart. They were physically together. They were with each other. They were encouraging one another. They were sharing each other's burdens. I can imagine some of the tough things that they were going through. And they were supporting one another. And when God's people come together like that, and they pray for the Holy Spirit to be poured out, the Holy Spirit gets poured out. Because they've done the work of coming together and opening themselves up to receive the blessing. You see, the Holy Spirit gave them power to speak that day. And through the Spirit, Jesus made the disciples into apostles. They all were given a voice. And that voice didn't just come from their vocal cords, it came through the Holy Spirit. At that moment, the apostles discovered their then what. The then what was about to begin. And I believe that you have a then what too. I believe that God has a then what for each and every one of you. Listen, our then what as a church or as individuals will never be fully realized unless the presence of Jesus Christ through the power of the Holy Spirit baptizes us. In fact, if you look at the story of the church of Laodicea, the seventh church, the last church before Jesus comes, If you look at that story, it says at the very end, the antidote for the lukewarm condition of the church, us today, is letting Jesus in. What is he doing? He's standing at the door and he's knocking. And we let Jesus in. Now, Jesus, when he gave his life on the cross, when he came down to become one of us, a human being, he gave up his omnipresence. And so he relies on the Holy Spirit to come into your heart, to work in your life. So when Jesus says, I will come to you, as he did in John 14, I will come to you through the Holy Spirit, he's saying, this is the reality. When the Holy Spirit fills you, I come into your life. And everything will change. And so this knocking on the door, us letting Jesus in, is the equivalent of letting the Holy Spirit do its work in our lives, to baptize us and to bring Christ and his presence, making it a reality for us every day. I was talking to a friend of mine. This is a buddy for 30 plus years. We grew up together. We were in church school together. And you know, I don't ever remember the church and our teachers talking about the Holy Spirit. The most important thing that will give me, that would give us strength to live the life that Christ wanted us to live, was kind of left out. Oh, we knew the Holy Spirit. I mean, he was the third person of the Godhead, all those things. But the practical application of the Spirit of God filling us as young men was out. And what was focused on was doing everything we can to keep God's law. Do you remember growing up in this era? Come on. The focus was on obedience to God's law. And obedience to God's law is a good thing. We are called to be obedient to God's law. But you and I can't do it under our own power. So imagine telling somebody you have to do this, but you can't. Right? You have to keep God's law and make sure you don't commit any sin and all these things, and knowing, well, they can't do it because they don't have the Holy Spirit in them. So today, I shouldn't say today, this is a little while ago, and we were talking about it, in fact, just recently. But I was saying, hey, you know, our life in Christ isn't about all the stuff we have to do for God to accept us. It's about the stuff that we do because Jesus dwells in us through his Spirit, and he helps us to follow and walk in his ways. And it's a different way of thinking about things, isn't it? You know, we all struggle with stuff in our life. And we often think, well, if I just try harder, right? If I just try harder, I can overcome this. No, you can't. If there's anything you need to do, it's to just die harder and let God fill you and do the work for you. And herein lies the issue. Because as I talk about this, my appeal to you is going to be, please pray for the Holy Spirit to fill your life with Jesus, that everything you do, everything you think, every decision you make is permeated with this awareness of Christ's presence in your life. That's my appeal. That's what I'm going to ask you to do. See, I already gave the appeal to you before we even finished. But I also want to acknowledge that there's a battle when you do this. Because the devil doesn't fear you at all. He can overcome you when he wants to, as long as Jesus doesn't live in your life. And if he can keep you just trying as hard as you can on your own to buck up and to overcome and to do what you're supposed to do as a good Christian. He's got you right where he wants you, because when the tough time comes, your faith breaks down. You can't do what you habitually practiced to do because the Holy Spirit hasn't been there. The reason why Jesus said, wait until the Holy Spirit comes upon you, is because he knew that these disciples couldn't begin to accomplish in their lives what he wanted them to do without his power. In Mark 11:24, it says, in Jesus' words, therefore I say to you, whatever things you ask when you pray, believe that you receive them and you will have them. The context is provided in other passages, which describes the things that you ask for being for the glory of God, right? He's not going to give you everything that doesn't glorify him. He doesn't bring things into your life that don't do you any good. You could pray for a Ferrari, and I can promise you it's not coming. Unless you're like a top race car driver, and that's your life, and you need one. But most of us don't need a Ferrari. I'd like one, but I don't need one. Believing is not complete simply by asking. I'll let this sink in. Believing is not complete simply because you asked. It's completed by receiving. Believe that you what? Receive them. You believe that you receive them, not I believe that I just asked for it. Of course you just asked for it. It's the receiving that you need to believe in. Belief is an act of dependence upon God. Trusting God to fulfill his promise changes our ability to receive the things we've asked for. When I say, when I've asked for something from the Lord, a blessing from the Lord, it's when I trust him to fulfill that blessing, to step in and provide me for what I need. And my walk from that point on is the belief that he will do that as I'm walking through life. That's belief. That's biblical belief. And all the more for receiving the Holy Spirit. We can't just ask for the Holy Spirit and then go on with life as usual. It doesn't work like that. We're to receive the Holy Spirit. God does not hold back the outpouring of the Holy Spirit. He knows we need him. The reason we don't experience the power of God's indwelling spirit and the fullness of a life in Christ is because, number one, we don't ask for the promise. That's a given. But number two, we don't receive the promise. Everyone willing to receive the Holy Spirit will be filled with the Holy Spirit. But instead of preparing to receive the blessing, what happens in our life? Trivial things occupy our attention and quench the gift. We forget what we've asked for, and life goes on as usual. Listen, if you would invite a guest to your house and then do nothing to get ready for their arrival, how would they feel when they get there? Not welcome. Rochelle and I have kind of gotten used to this drill. I think we kind of go through this drill. Well, the best way to clean your house is to invite somebody over. Anybody know that rule? Yeah. It works every time. Right. So we invite people over, and then what happens? We clear our calendar, we clean the house, we prepare a room, we buy extra food, all so that our guests will feel welcomed and appreciated. You see, life is thrown, it goes completely abnormal. We do all these things to get ready for the guests to come.
So it is with the Holy Spirit. We ask for the Holy Spirit, and what happens if we just go about life like doing what we always do? Do you think the Holy Spirit's going to pour out his blessing into your life? No, it doesn't work that way. He says, put your house in order. You've asked for my Spirit. I'm willing to pour the Spirit into your life and to begin doing that right now. Let's work on this together. And then the Spirit's ready to go, and we go about life as if we've never asked. I don't know if you've... We like to watch like old English history stories and things, Victorian era and other things. We enjoy that. There's a room in the house that we don't use this terminology anymore, but there was a room in the house, and it carried over also into the United States for quite a while. It's just been lost since. It's called the receiving room. How many of you are familiar with this term? The receiving room. This is the room that is especially prepared for you to receive your guests and to provide, you know, good conversation, some tea, maybe some other things that they would enjoy. It's to help them feel welcome and warmed by just coming out for a visit. I think we should do the same with Jesus, shouldn't we? He's knocking. When we open up the door, that's the equivalent of saying, all this stuff that absorbs my attention, that I'm putting more time and energy in than you in our relationship together, all that stuff has to be put aside, laid aside, so I can prepare my heart to receive you and spend time with you. And as long as we keep on going with life as usual, things will never change. We'll never get the power that we need to live the fullness of a new life in Christ. James said in chapter 4, verse 3, you ask and do not receive because you ask amiss, that you may spend it on what? Your pleasures. See, you're asking for stuff that isn't God's target, it's your target. And what it really does is it reveals your heart. Again, if you go about life the same way you did before, you ask God for his blessing, then nothing will change. Instead of receiving the blessing, you end up quenching it. And this is a cycle, as a pastor, that I've seen in people over and over and over again. Is it possible to believe in Jesus without ever making him a part of your life? Is it possible? It's possible initially, yes, to accept Christ's gift of salvation and never really let him in. I think the disciples went through a bit of this. You know, they spent time with him, but what happened when the Roman guards came and took him? After they promised that he would die with them, right? After they would die with him. They scattered. They were gone. It took failure to realize what we need within us, which is Christ through his Spirit constantly at work, guiding us and leading us through life. I think the other challenge is we tend to compartmentalize our life. We have this space for family. We have this space for friends. We have a space for work, for play. Oh, and we have this space for church. And Jesus is, you know, part of that space. Jesus wants access to every part of your life. He doesn't want a compartment of your life. He wants you to say, take it all. Either we give him everything or we don't give him anything. And this kind of commitment, this kind of devotion to Christ has no problem and letting the Holy Spirit take over the steering wheel of your life. Now, I've had many failures. It's taken a long time to grow up, to learn how not only the devil overcomes me, but to learn how to set up a defense and trust in the power of God in my life to resist him. Not only that, for the Holy Spirit to change my desires and the things that I want in life that are so much more meaningful now than they ever were before. So I just thought, you know, let me just give you a few points here to share from my own life, my own experience with Christ and the power of the Holy Spirit that has baptized and come upon me. Number one is conviction. It all begins with conviction that where we are now, what we are, is failing. I'm a sinner. I need God to save me. And then repentance, which also brings confession. When you repent, it means you turn 180 degrees and go the other direction. You choose to walk the other way. And as you repent and confess, you're accepting Christ. That's acceptance of Jesus and his gift of salvation. Now, this is sadly where many Christians stop. Number three. It's it. It's over, right? The end. Happily ever after. But the devil says, all right, now the battle's really begun, right? So then the fourth step, and this is the step that was hardest to learn. And it will be a hard thing to learn for you, I believe. Asking and receiving. You see, the asking and receiving isn't just a one-time event. Asking and receiving is continual. Every single day, Lord, I'm here on my knees this morning because I know that the battle starts when I start my day. And unless you are with me and fill me with your Spirit this morning, I am going to fail. I'm giving you my prayer. This is my prayer every morning. Lord, I can't lead a church. I can't provide an example for the church. In my own personal life, I can't be the husband that Rochelle needs me to be. I can't do anything without you. So my hands then turn up and I say, Lord, fill me now with your Holy Spirit. I mean, as I ask, Lord, fill me with your Holy Spirit, I lay down what I want to do and I choose. I make a deliberate choice to do what you want me to do. Take the wheel, guide my life. You lead, we'll see where things go. Oh, and I do have an itinerary, I've got some plans, but if you want to alter those plans, you're free to alter them. He's been doing a lot of that lately, actually. Now, when I do that, and I get up, and I begin to go through my day, I'm hearing a voice. I'm hearing the way of God as he asked me to walk in it, right? There are several Old Testament scriptures about this. To the left and to the right, as we walk, he tells us where to turn. He tells us who needs help, where to go. He instructs me when I need some wisdom. If anybody lacks wisdom, let him ask of God. He'll provide it. And so two things result from this. Personal transformation. I am transformed every day that I give my life to Christ again, and I ask for his Spirit to fill me. And then secondly, cooperation. I cooperate with the leading of his Spirit throughout the day as well. And this is often a struggle. Because sometimes the person cuts me off on the road, or, you know, I hear of someone telling some lies, like it's getting frustrating, or something else happens that really kind of tests my faith, and I have to just stand down and cooperate with how the Spirit is moving. This cooperation is me constantly in interaction with the Holy Spirit, and which is Christ then speaking into my life and following his leading. Lord, where is it you're asking me to go? How do you want me to make a decision on this? What choice should I make? Where do I need to lead? And sometimes the answer isn't clear, so I simply say, okay, Lord, I'm going to take steps forward here. Close the door if it's not the right way. Or if it's the right way I should go, open it wider so I can see where you're leading me. Do you see the daily experience? I'm bearing my soul to give you my daily experience with Jesus. This is what being a Christian who is filled with the Holy Spirit looks like. And I'm not saying I'm perfect by any means. I still have failures. But this is what God asks, he wants to do in our life. And I know, like with the series that we just did, and the interest we now have from this series, I know personally I can't do all the follow-up. And so who do I lean on? Pastor Mark, Pastor Melanie, yeah. Who else do I lean on? You. But more specifically, I lean on people that are filled with the Holy Spirit because I know that as God leads them, that they will be able to lead somebody else into a knowledge and understanding of Christ as their Savior too. During the Welsh revival of the early 1900s, more than 100,000 people joined churches. We're talking about Wales, not a huge area. 100,000 people joined churches. Some 250,000 people gave their lives to Christ, either in as a revival or is in a new way, a new relationship. And it also sparked revivals around the world. People flocked to hear preachers. Newspapers reported on the incredible changes that were taking place. It was a powerful experience. But Christianity in Wales has been in decline ever since. And today, by their own admission, it's very weak. You see, God does want to revive you and me. He wants to revive us. But he also wants us to stay revived. The reason why the church keeps praying for revival, follow me, is because we can't seem to stay revived from the last time we did a revival. There's going to come a time, and I see it on the horizon, that the last revival will take place. And my brothers and my sisters, it's time that we are revived and that we stay revived. And that the power of the Holy Spirit comes on us in a way that is so life-transforming that it teaches us how to truly walk with Jesus moment by moment throughout each and every day. So that he can send us where he needs to send us. That we can give the things that are needed by people that need them. So that we as a church, as we do ministry, it becomes I can't help myself ministry, I love Jesus, instead of do I have to ministry because they've asked me. Right? That's what a revived, thriving church looks like. Some might say we need to do this or that, or you know, change, you know, the way we're teaching, or the music, or you know, we add skits or whatever. And then, of course, people will come out. No. What we need is a church whose members are filled with the Holy Spirit and can't help but not only love Jesus, but love other people and serve and minister to their needs. If you feel like you have to do something, then it's time to get on your knees and pray for the Holy Spirit. Honestly. Because those that are filled with the Spirit happily give up whatever they have planned, happily defer to whatever need that somebody has. And as they said in the Old Testament, all of them brought what they had and they gave to those who lacked. And we say, oh, that can't happen again. Yes, it can. If the power of God through His Spirit resides in us. I read this devotional thought this past week from John Barry. He wrote this, even though I know it's wrong, this is a friend of him who came to him, friend of his who came to him and said these words. Even though I know it's wrong, I sometimes think if I hadn't accepted Christ, I would have so much more freedom. And then I ventured down that road and realized just how terrible that thought is. It takes me to a very dark place. And then in response to that, his friend saying that, he says these words. This deep, heart-wrenching statement by a friend made me realize there are countless people who probably feel the same way about Jesus. And what if, unlike my friend, they hadn't figured out the latter part of his statement? They were probably walking a road closer to legalism than the road Christ envisions for our lives. Or they could be so far from actually experiencing grace and the empowerment of the Holy Spirit that they have yet to see how incredible life lived for Jesus can actually be. Life in Christ is beautiful. It's not something you can manufacture, conjure up, or push yourself into. It's when the Holy Spirit comes into your life, you are a new creation. It is a beautiful life. I've never heard a pastor on his deathbed say, boy, I wish I had done less for Jesus. They always say, I wish I had done more for Christ. You see, Jesus wants to move you into the then what aspect of your life. A living, breathing, contagious life in Christ that brings personal transformation and united cooperation amongst the church in the work of His kingdom. And I believe that time is coming. We saw it at Pentecost. We read about it in Pentecost with the former rain. The latter rain is beginning to be poured out. I believe it's starting. And could it mean that the last revival may be starting? I don't know the answer to that question. I don't know where you stand. But I do know this, with the power of the living Christ in you, in your life, it'll be completely different than any attempt to live for Jesus on your own. What did receiving the Holy Spirit do for the disciples? It says in Acts 2:41 that those who gladly received His word were baptized, and that day about how many souls were added? 3,000 souls were added in a day. We're seeing some of these examples around the world by some of our evangelistic efforts. There are numerous thousands of people coming, responding to the gospel. But what I want to do is I want to end with this invitation from Jesus. You're done hearing from me. Let me share these words from Christ in Luke 11. It's our last text. Verse 9. Jesus said to His disciples, so I say to you, ask, and it will be given to you. Seek, and you will find. Knock, and it will be opened unto you. For everyone who asks receives, and he who seeks finds, and to him who knocks it will be opened. If a son asks for bread from any father among you, will he give him a stone? Or if he asks for a fish, will he give him a serpent instead of a fish? Or if he asks for an egg, will he offer him a scorpion? If you then, being evil, yeah, we do have evil hearts. If you then, being evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your heavenly Father give the Holy Spirit to those who ask Him? Will you ask Him today? Will you ask Him? Will you ask him every morning? And as your reminder on your phone pops up saying pray, will you ask him again throughout the day? You see, Jesus recognizes these efforts that we put to clean the house, to get ourselves ready for the Holy Spirit, and he will respond. Because when you do those things, you are preparing to receive. You've not only asked, but you're preparing to receive, and he will fill you. And you will have and find a love for Jesus that you've never had before. This is my desire for you. This is my desire for you. This is Christ. This is Jesus' desire for you. A life full of his presence and an awareness that he is with you and will keep you and will help you walk through this life no matter where the journey takes you. There's nothing better than confidence in Christ who lives within you. Amen. Father, I pray as I'm making an appeal through this prayer as well, I pray that you would touch our hearts and minds with a renewed desire to be filled with your Spirit, to give up the things in this life that don't matter, to reorder ourselves and our life to bring only the good in. As we ask for your Spirit, I know that as you see this, you say, oh, this is one who is seeking, and he will find, or she will find, and I will fill her or him. Lord, I pray that you would fill your people today, that you would come into our lives, take over the wheel, drive the car to where we need to go, change the equipment, our life, our heart, our mind, renew us, and then make us into your people who cooperate with the work that you're trying to do, which is to get the everlasting gospel to everyone so that Jesus may come and save everyone he possibly can. Lord, it begins with you and us individually. And I pray that you will show up in a powerful way as all of those hearing today will dedicate their time and energy every morning and every day to asking for your Spirit and preparing to receive him. We thank you in advance for that blessing. In Jesus' name, amen.